we're continuing with our series on freedom. This is the fourth week of freedom, and I don't know about you, but I am always encouraged when I open the Word of God and find out the freedom that's available to us. Really, the basic title is Freedom, Discovering the Divine You, and we mentioned this before. We believe every single person is made in the image of God. The Bible says, before you were formed in your mother's womb, I knew you, and that includes the entire world. Everyone that's alive here today, they're accidental parents, but there's no accidental children. We believe every person has a divine purpose from God that he can utilize. We really believe that. And the problem is the world has rejected Christ, and our objective is to help Christ to be known. And not only that, but we want people to find the freedom that God has for you. God has freedom for you. Freedom to become the person that God has created you to be. But we have an enemy. The enemy's job is to lie, steal, kill, and destroy. Yes, there is an enemy. Yes, he's called the devil. Yes, he has a huge force that comes against us. But the Bible says greater is he that's within us than he that's in the world. So we've been talking about freedom, and we've been talking about how we can limit our freedom by opening doors to the enemy of our lives. And I'll make it abundantly clear, there's no such thing as a yin and a yang where the evil and the good fight against you. No, God is much stronger than the enemy. However, the enemy's power comes when we believe a lie and live in a lie. You see, what God has done, you see throughout Scripture, God gave dominion to the earth, to mankind, to rule and to reign. We gave it over to the enemy. And when God does something, he usually asks for men and women to stand in the gap. We come in partnership, all right? So, the enemy understands that. So if the enemy can get us to believe a lie and to accept a lie, then he has power over us. His greatest power is lying. So, one of the greatest ways to get free is that you shall know the truth, and it will set you free. So we talked about that. We talked about the whole reason why we fast is to get closer to God. We talked about knowing, applying the truth. And a couple of weeks ago, I spoke very, very clearly on one of the most important access points the enemy has in our life. It's the area of pride. Pride is the big P word. And what the big P word is, it's pride. And what that is, it's a master key into every area of my life and your life. I have a master key for this building. I can go wherever I want to with this one key. And other people have keys that are limited to different places. When you give into pride, you basically give the devil the key to your house, key to your car, key to everything. You give him all your passcodes. Because pride is a huge issue. We dealt with that. I encourage you to go back and listen how the enemy has access point, because I cannot re-preach it. So if you hear some things today, like, wait a minute, how can that possibly happen? Go on to cornerstonecheshire.com and listen to it and get caught up. It will help you. It will help me. And it's all about Scripture. And that's what's happening. Today, actually, let me see what's going on here. Okay, I had the right notes. I apologize. The last service, I couldn't get my iPad to work. I used my computer. And we are on the right notes today, so you're in good hands here. So today we're talking about how we can get free and remain free. Freedom. And I want to mention to you, if you could open your Bibles to John chapter 8, starting at verse 31. We're going to read. This has been our anchor verse. This has been our launch pad, pun intended, for the kids. This has been our area where we've been launching from every week. We've been unpacking the significance of John chapter 8, verse 31 to 36. I'm going to go ahead and read it again to you this morning. All right, you're going to open your Bibles or your iPads or Androids or no droids, whatever, or flip phones. Okay, John 8, 31. Then Jesus said to those Jews who believed him. Okay, let's just stop there for a moment. Jesus is talking to the church of his day. They are believers, not pagans, not those outside, believers. If you abide in my word, in other words, if you abide, if you live in my word, if you live in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you will know the truth. And the word know in the Greek is gnosko. Gnosko is an intimate knowledge of. It's not reciting information. It's a gnosko. For example, you know you're sitting in a chair. You're experiencing that chair right now, and it's holding you up. You know that chair. Well, you shall know the truth. And the truth might make you free. No, the truth will set you free. And the reason why truth is so powerful is because truth is not just a thing. It is a person. Jesus says, I am the way, I am the, and I am the life. Truth is Jesus Christ. Knowledge is not truth. Knowledge is information. Biblical truth is knowledge married to Jesus Christ and his love. That's truth. Knowledge is not truth. You shall know the truth, which is Jesus, and the truth shall make you free. Now, I'm going to go a little deeper than I have in the past in this little section. He's talking to the church of his day. And all of a sudden, they answered him. The church answered him, "Hey, we're Abraham's descendants, and we've never been in bondage to anyone." Apparently, they never read the book. If you read the Old Testament, where were the Israelites for over 400 years? They were what? In slavery. I mean, it's ridiculous. You'll find that people that are in bondage or that are under the subjection of the enemy are not even aware of it. For over 400 years, they were under slavery. Then you had the Phoenicians. You had the Philistines. You had the Persians, the Babylonians. All these people, they were under slavery. Listen to what they say here. It's one of the most ridiculous verses in the Bible. They answered, "We're Abraham's descendants. We've never been in bondage to anyone. How can you say you'll be made free?" So they were in bondage to that. Not only that, do you realize that Jesus was talking to the church of his day? Guess who they were in subjection to when the time he was talking to them? The Romans. And so that's an illustration. Many people say in the church, "I'm free, I have no issues at all. It's all on the cross, and you know, you can't do that." Well, let me make something very, very clear to you. Unfortunately, when they translated the Greek into the King James Version, which is back a long time ago, they used the word possessed. And that's not a very good English word to use, because possessed would give the connotation that it has complete ownership of you. And that's not what the Greek word is. The Greek word is demonized. And it would be like, for example, if you have mice in your house, or you have ants, and you have them in your house. They may not control your house, they don't own your house, but they're infested in your house. And my friends, make no mistake, that's why you can have demonic strongholds infesting your life. God owns the deed, he gave price the deed to your house, but you've allowed it to happen. You can be under the influence, for example. If I choose, which I, by the way, I've never gotten drunk in my life, if I had a quart of Jack Daniels, which I would never do, and I got in an automobile, and I drove, and meanwhile, there's a guy that's a Satanist gets in a car, and he drinks a quarter of a Jack Daniels and drives in a car, and we both get in an accident. Well, I'm a believer, and he's a Satanist. We're both under the influence of the alcohol, and we're going to make bad decisions. The alcohol does not own me, but I'm under the influence. And so the enemy can influence us to act in a way that's unbecoming of what God would have for us. So they're making it very clear, he's saying here. He said, "You shall know the truth, and truth will make you free." Verse 34. Jesus answered them, "Most assuredly I say to you, whoever," this is the part I want you to underline, "whoever commits," you want to underline commits, "whoever commits a sin is a slave to sin." We're going to go back to that word in a few moments. Let's continue to read. "And a slave does not abide in the house forever, but a son abides." That there's rights and privileges that God gives us as children of God. Because my children are my children, they have rights to be in the house. I guess no one can just come in the house and come in our house, "Hey, Dad, I want something to eat." No, I mean, these people, they're my children. They have rights, sort of. They march in our bedroom and then eat all our food. But anyhow, I mean, they have rights as children. They're part of the family. And so we have rights. So I say, whoever commits a sin is a slave to sin. And a slave does not abide in the house forever, but a son abides forever. Therefore, if, this is the good part, if the Son, there's a condition, if the Son sets you free, you shall be
free.
Free indeed. Okay, so we're talking about freedom today, continued freedom, and we're going to talk about more access points the enemy can go. We're going to talk about three different areas this morning. We mentioned pride's the big P, and that's the master key that gets for everything. But there's some other areas I want to encourage you about today that we can learn, be educated about, and then begin to practice how we can shut the door and keep out the devil. Shut the door and keep the devil in the night. Okay. Who knows that song? Okay, all three of you. Okay. The 1980s, when I had a mullet. And I had more hair. And women wore shoulder pads. Okay. As believers, we can choose sonship, but we can fall back into bondage. You know what the Greek word says? It says this: those who commit sin. You know what it means in the Greek? It means to formulate a plan. Formulate a plan. So it's not like you make a mistake, oh, I committed a sin. No, this is when you make a plan to sin. This is when you're committed to sin. This is when you say, okay, I'm going on a business trip. I'm going to stay an extra day, and I'm going to see an old flame I used to know in college. Or I'm going to go on a trip and do this. Or now everyone's to bed. I got the passcode ready. I'm going to click and watch some certain things because, after all, my spouse is not giving what I need, and I'm a man, and I'm a woman, and I need it. Or you can dealt with somebody also, not in this church. I'm going to make it very clear. By the way, if I give an example, I am not talking about anyone in this church. If it bothers you, get over it. It's your own problem. I will not break confidences on Sunday morning. But we've dealt with people that have got on the internet and started a relationship through chatting back and forth. And, oh, this guy, he's so nice. And we go back and forth and talk, and they have a relationship on the internet. Okay? That is a way to open the door to the enemy. And so what happens is committed, when you're committed to sin. You're committed. You make a plan. Okay, I'm going to go away and do this. I'm going to look at this. I'm going to say this. I know the Bible says, render unto what is God is God's. In other words, give to God and render to what is Caesar. Give to the government what the governments have. You should pay taxes, the Bible says. But after all, I don't believe that's right, so I'm not going to do it. What you're doing is you are committing a sin. You are purposely planning to sin. When you purposely become stingy and you choose not to give what God has given you, you are opening yourself to a door to the enemy. I'm going to step on some toes right now. I'm sorry, it's in the Word of God. Bible says in Malachi, test me and see if not, I will open the windows of heaven. How have we robbed you? You've robbed me with your tithes and your offerings. You are under a curse. When you are a gimme, gimme, my name is Jimmy, and it's all about getting and getting, you refuse to give back what God's given you, you are opening the door to the enemy to attack your finances, to attack everything you do, because you say it's all yours. It's not yours, it's his, if you're giving your life to Christ. So, whoever commits a sin is a slave to sin. And this is what begins to happen. Committed to formulate a plan. How many of us formulate plans about doing things? We're going to go out, have a good time. Oh, I'm going to a stag party. Oh, awesome. You know, at a stag party, what happens at a stag party stays in a stag party, right? So we're going to go. I mean, I've seen people, you know, I'm not going to get on that right now, but this is what happens. It's bondage. Or, you know, I know I shouldn't say this, but let me tell you a little juicy morsel about somebody. You know, this person over here that did this, this, and the other. I know I'm supposed to forgive, but you know what? That person, I'm only human. I heard this too, by the way. I've heard this. I know the Bible says that, but I'm only human. So let me go. God will forgive. Let me go ahead and just do this. Let me go ahead and be angry at this person. Let me go ahead and commit this situation. And you know when you do that? You know what you're doing? You're like, okay, here the enemy. Open the door. That's what you're doing. Open the door. It says in Romans 6:16, do you realize that you become a slave of whatever you choose to obey? You can be a slave to sin, which leads to life. Come on, the first service was a lot better than that. Leads to death, or you can choose to obey God, which leads to righteous living. He's talking about believers. He's not talking about those outside the church. In fact, Jesus was extremely difficult on the church people, and he gave grace to those outside the church. Have you noticed the church is easy on church people? And man, we're tough on the world. The world's job is to sin. That's the job of the world. But we're like, oh, no. Judgment begins in the house. We should look out for each other. Hey, I care about you. You shouldn't be doing that. And so that's all part of it. He's talking about believers. He says, whatever you choose, whatever you do, you become a slave to. Whatever you obey, you become a slave to sin, which leads to death. Or you can choose God, which leads to righteous, right living. Understand something. I know this can come across like I'm on a, you know, fire and brimstone message. God's angry at you, and he enjoys throwing lightning bolts at you. And I love to see everyone in hell. No, that's not what we're talking about here. What we're talking about here is this. God loves you so much, he doesn't want to see you limit the capacity you have. I get a little agitated if my child, Matthew, for example, he decides he's going to run outside and run into the road. I'm going to be a little bit animated, by the way. I might raise my voice a little bit. I might grab them and say, what are you doing? Why? I love my son, and I'm passionate about my relationship with my son and my children, and I don't want to see them get hurt. And so I'll be passionate. I'll grab them if I have to protect them. And God is passionate about his relationship with his church. And he wants to see us to walk in freedom. Who you're going to believe, whatever you listen to, you become a slave to. Well, that's just the way I am. God, I have this weak area, so it's okay. Really disturbed. I don't care for how I say this. No one in this church, once again, but I spoke to somebody recently who was in the ministry, and they lived a double life for years. I just can't imagine. Anyhow, let's go to Jeremiah 7, 8. There's something a little bit more of a, I'm going to show you another scripture verse that will help bring clarity to what we're talking about, because all scripture is approved and worthy of doctrine and correction. So Jeremiah 7, 8, and 11. Behold, you trust in lying words that cannot profit. Will you steal, murder, commit adultery, swear falsely, burn incense to Baal, and walk after other gods whom you do not know, and then come and stand before me in this house, which is called by my name, and say, oh, we are delivered to do all these abominations. Has this house, which is called by my name, become a den of thieves in your eyes? Behold, I have seen it, says the Lord. So how many people that happens to us? And by the way, Jesus quoted that the disciples saw that scripture when he turned over the tables in the courtyard of the temple. How many of us just go, oh yeah, I'll do what I want to do. Praise God. Hallelujah. We'll live like the devil all week long. Go to the confessional booth. Forgive me, Father, I have sinned. Come back to church. I'm good. I'm okay. It's almost like one of those mafia movies. You know, son, you should go to church. You know, and then they go to the confessional booth and it's all okay. Listen, you know, we do all these things and we act like it's no big deal. But I have some news for you that there's a symbol of a temple here. But you know what happened when Jesus died on the cross? When Jesus died on the cross, the Bible says that veil was torn in two. What is the veil? The veil was there was a Holy of Holies in the temple. And when Jesus died on the cross, it used to be the high priest only. When Jesus died on the cross, access to everyone to go to the Holy of Holies. And the Bible says, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit? I've had someone get upset with me one time, not in this church again. He said, I can't believe we're going to show a movie in the house of God. It was actually a clean movie. It was no problem. It was only, you know, full metal jacket. It was fine. I'm just kidding. That's not what we show. But we show a movie in church, and I'm like, wait a minute here. I said, do you ever watch a movie? Oh, yeah, I love movies. Okay. Do you know that you're the temple of the Holy Spirit? This church building is dedicated for God, and it's great we come here, and we bless God, we honor God, but really the defiled part is your own temple. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. This is just a building. And so that's all part of the process. He's talking to that. And so it talks about in the scriptures that there's so many symbols of the temple. And today I believe that Jesus is walking through the courtyards of our life and he sees thieves that are stealing what his house is supposed to be. And God does not like it because he wants you to have freedom. And when you do stuff and don't listen to God, what you do is you shackle yourself, you invite the enemy in, the enemy gets a foothold, and he begins to take jurisdiction on something that's not supposed to be. So many people, I don't have any animals at this point. We can't seem to keep them alive when we have them. Hamsters, fish, you name it. Thank God everything else stays alive. But anyhow, I know some of you that have dogs. And what you've done is you've put an electric, invisible fence, they call it, an invisible fence, and they put these wires through the yard, and apparently they put this thing on the dog's neck, the poor dog, and if the dog crosses the line, it gets shocked. Why don't you do it to yourself and see how you like it? But anyhow, that's beside the point. So many of us have invisible fences in our lives. We're trying to go forward in our relationship. We're trying to go forward with God. We're trying to go forward in how we live our lives. We're trying to go forward in how we spend money and all that. And it seems like you get to a certain level, something stops you, that you're encapsulated, you're in bondage, you're held back because of something that's around your neck. Well, Jesus wants to come today and take that thing off of you and get you free from that invisible fence. So many of us, you don't know what's going on in your life, but you're under bondage. Let me ask you a question. If today there was a knock at your apartment or your door,
And you look at the people and you see an Islamic individual with a head thing, and he's got plastic explosives strapped to his chest, and he has an Uzi in his hand. Are you going to open the door and welcome him in? That was really racist, Pastor. I'm sorry. If it's a jihadist, okay? ISIS shows up at your door, or a guy in a ski mask with a gun. Are you going to open the door? Of course not. I don't know about you, but I'm gonna run out the other side. Right? Do you know what happens, though? We do it all the time. The enemy knocks on our door. Don't forgive that person. Hey, click me. Oh, wow, this person from high school, wow. I wonder how they're doing. You know, I want to counsel them in their marriage. This is for somebody this morning. You don't counsel another person in their marriage of the opposite sex. Let me say that very, very clearly right now. It never works. You're opening yourself to all kinds of problems. Don't try to kid yourself. That's for someone this morning watching, or I don't know, but stop it. Stop it now before it's too late. You know what I'm talking about. I just sent someone this morning, or someone going to watch this later on is involved with that. You need to stop it right now. Okay, back to our regularly scheduled program here. You would not open it up. But you know what happens when we open up doors? I don't know if you realize this, guys, but I had a drug problem growing up. A serious drug problem. I mean, really bad. In fact, I still feel it today in my blood. My parents drug me to church. They drug me to school. They drug me to trombone lessons. They drug me to Little League. They drug me to grandma's house. They drug me to church. They drug me to youth group. They drug me to summer camp. And you know what happened? It's still in my blood today. Parents, we need to drag your children to the right places, because right now you have authority over their lives. I got that from Joel Osteen on XM Radio. I was driving my car. I thought it was a great one. And he got it from somebody else. We need to take authority. And listen, this is serious stuff, folks. Why are you going to have your children with a headset on, talking to their friends, shooting people's heads off in a Mortal Kombat or whatever these games are? I don't know if you realize this, but do you realize the first people to make video-type games were? It was the military in the 1950s. Because there's squeamish guys that couldn't pull the trigger and blow someone away, if you will. You couldn't shoot somebody. So they made these war games. Things would pop up, and they'd shoot them. They start doing computer games. Do you know what happens? Mario's a little different, I guess. Mario's a little different. Okay, or Legos. Okay. But when you're sitting there and you're shooting a gun, and, you know, it's so graphic now. My son showed me MLB 2016. It's like going to the ball game. This crowd, it's so vivid. And you feel like you're in the middle of a ball game. Well, you're sitting here in a war game, whatever, and you're sitting there blowing people's heads off, and you're sniping, and all of a sudden you see one's head blow up, and you see all blood. I'm sorry to be so graphic, but this is what happens. You don't think that affects you? You better believe it affects you. It can create a bloodlust in you. Or at worst, at best, you become cold-hearted to crime. No big deal. They get themselves blown away. That's demonic. I hate to say it. Or, you know, well, it's just zombies, whatever. Listen, you deal with it your own way. You're shooting up things. You're practicing killing things, and you're doing it not in a way of sport. You're doing it in a way of fun, and it's really graphic. I don't think that's really good, folks. I'm sorry to say. Or when I was a kid, I used to, like, watch slasher movies. I used to like Freddy. Remember Freddy? Okay. I used to like watching those movies. But, you know, that was the occult. That was, like, Ouija boards and all that. I opened myself to the occult by watching those things. Those things are really real. Not Freddy, but all the other stuff. And so what can happen is you can open the door to these things. Or how about watching movies? My wife and I were told, well, you got to watch this program. It's fantastic. It shows about the drug cartel in the 1980s. And you know, you turn it on, and oh, my goodness, we can't watch this. Click, click. And they're showing naked people. Now, am I going to have someone come to my house and disrobe? Of course not. So we allow this stuff in our lives, and it invites the enemy's presence. The enemy goes, listen, they're allowing killing, murder, pornography, guilt, all that stuff, unforgiveness. Hey, and what the enemy does, by the way, the enemy is just like if the police want to come to your house and search your house, they have to get a search warrant. The enemy will come to God, hey, God, Look at this, man. He's doing this, and he knows better. She knows better. I have a right to meddle in their affair. And God goes, you know what? You do have a right. Go ahead. You open your life to the Lord's, to the enemy's meddling in your life. I don't know about you. I don't want that to happen. You can allow things. Well, I don't believe that can happen in Scripture. Well, all you can see, go back to 2 weeks ago and hear it, and it gives it more explanation. So that's one thing right now, opening doors. Let's go to the second thing this morning. The first one is opening doors, practicing iniquity, continuing with certain sin, not just falling once, but practicing it. My friends, it's a stronghold. The second thing that can happen, and I want to qualify this before I even say it, okay? What I'm about ready to say is controversial. It's been abused by the church so bad that we've gone the opposite direction. Let me make something clear. I'm not saying this is for every case, but in some cases, and I'm going to show Scripture to support what I'm saying. Sometimes the enemy can come through chronic sickness. Doesn't mean if you have a cold, you have a demon. It doesn't mean if Aunt Millie has cancer that she's a worship Satan. No, it doesn't mean that. But the enemy can come in through chronic sickness. What I encourage you to do, which I'll share in a few moments, if you're a pilot on an airplane, a commercial airline, they have a pilot and a co-pilot there in the front. They say, check, engine check, check. And what do they go through? A whole series of checklists before they put that plane in the air. They do a checklist of all the vital instruments on the plane. And then they ask the control tower, how are we doing? You're clear to go to runway 3 and taxi. And you have to do a checklist. My encouragement to you is that you need a checklist. And a pilot does not do a checklist by himself on a commercial or herself on a commercial airline. They have someone else. Do you have anyone else in your life that can help you with your checklist? Another believer that believes in you? Do you have anyone that can ask you the hard questions? I'm proud to say my friend David, who was last week, Pastor David, he can ask me any question he wants to. And we have a very honest relationship in regard. I have other people that can ask me questions. How's your prayer time? How are you and your wife doing? How are you treating your kids? How are you dealing with this? How are your eyes? How's your mind? How's your bitterness? Are you getting bitter towards anyone in the church? I got people asking me these questions. There's a checklist. Why? Because I recognize the fact that I can fall if I'm not careful. So this is what happens. Now, that being said, let's go ahead and let me say something else about this. Excuse me before I read this further. There was a movement in the church a period of time that if a person was sick, they didn't have enough faith, they must have opened the door to the enemy, and a lot of people felt really guilty about being sick. Well, Aunt Martha in South Dakota died of cancer because she has sin in her life. Listen, you and I don't have the ability to know why this happens, but you should ask yourself the question. Now, let's look at the Scripture and see what the Scripture has to say to bring more clarity. Okay, I know this is controversial. I didn't want to mention this, but it's in the Bible, so I have to mention it. Please understand. Don't get out there. You and I are not God. We don't understand what everyone goes through, but it's good to ask yourself the checklist. I'll show you in a few moments. Luke 13, verse 11 through 16. Luke 13. And behold, there was a woman who had a spirit of infirmity. A spirit of infirmity. In other words, there was a demonic spirit that was keeping her sick. Very clear in the Scriptures. For 18 years, and she was bent over and could not raise herself up. She had chronic back problems. But when Jesus saw her, he called her to himself and said, woman, you are loosed from your infirmity. And he laid his hands on her. Now, and immediately she was made straight. We believe in laying on of hands in the church here. We think it's scriptural. Okay, I'm not into these people that go pop and knock people down. I'm not into that. Okay? There's been times where I've seen people fall out under the power of God, but we're not into pushing people over and hitting them on the forehead with our hands, as happened to me a couple times. And I, like that, I hurt my teeth one time, a guy did that to me. Okay? They mean well, but, you know, God doesn't need help pushing anyone down. Okay? I'm sorry. If you see that on TV, I'm sorry. Let me just stop. I didn't mean to go there, but I did. But we're all for laying on of hands, okay? But when Jesus saw her, he said, woman, you're released of your infirmity. Verse 13, he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. Listen to this. But the ruler of the synagogue answered with indignation because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath. And he said to the crowd, there are 6 days on which men ought to work. Therefore, come and be healed on them and not on the Sabbath day. Well, when do people come to church? On the Sabbath. What better time to get healed? But they were legalistic. There's still Pharisees in the church today. Verse 15, the Lord answered to him and said, now this is what I want you to pay attention to, okay? The Lord answered him and said, you hypocrite, does not each of you on the Sabbath day loose his ox or donkey from the stall and lead it away to water? Now, verse 16, pay attention to. So ought not this woman, being a heathen, no, what does it say? Being a daughter of Abraham. She was a believer. She was the church lady. Well, not from SNL, but she was a woman who was a believer. Okay? So ought not this woman, being the daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has bound, think of it, for 18 years, be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath? So Jesus is saying that you can have a physical problem, a sickness that is perpetrated by the enemy. Now, if you have fear rising up in your abdomen, oh no, it's me, that's not of God. Okay? I don't know, I don't have the ability to discern everything. But Jesus says it very quickly here. Here's a daughter of Abraham. Do you know what it says in Galatians 3:7? Therefore, know that only those who are of faith are sons of Abraham. If you believe in Jesus Christ, you're a son of Abraham. Also, in Galatians 3:29, if you're of Christ, then you're of Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. All the promises of Abraham are mine in Christ Jesus. So, we are the same company she was. She's a daughter of, we're a daughter of Abraham too, a son of Abraham or a daughter of Abraham. I'm not saying that every single time you're sick, it's a demon. Ha-choo! Oh, it must be a demon. Well, by the way, did you know why people say God bless you for? I did the research on this one. Don't do it now through Google, please. They used to believe when you sneezed, an evil presence left your body. So they say, God bless you. Go, you gotta get rid of another demon. Sneeze again, please. You have a lot to sneeze. So every time you're sick doesn't mean it's a demon. All right, make that very, very clear. In Deuteronomy 28, 58 through 61, I'm just going to show you here through Scripture. If, this is what the Bible says. If you refuse to obey all the words of instruction that are written in this book, and if you do not fear the glorious and awesome name of the Lord your God, then the Lord will overwhelm you and your children with incredible plagues. Well, that's really encouraging. Thanks for, aren't you glad you came to church today? These plagues will be intense and without relief, making you miserable and unbearably sick. He will afflict you with all the diseases of the Egyptians that you feared so much, and you will have no relief. The Lord will afflict you from every sickness and plague there is, even those not mentioned in the book of instruction, until you are destroyed. Why don't you go home and print that and put it in the refrigerator? That's the one you want to commit to memory, right? I don't like that very much either, do you? But if we don't refuse to obey the words of God, if you decide today, leaving here, I'm going to drive on Interstate 84, and I am tired of the small-mindedness of the traffic patterns in Connecticut. What I'm going to do, instead of going with the traffic, I'm going to drive against the traffic instead, because I like a little excitement. And so you get on the highway, and you go the opposite way of traffic. Number one, you might get yourself killed, and you'll be arrested. Okay? When you and I don't listen to the word of God, we're basically saying, God, I don't care what you say. I'm in charge, and you're not. Listen, everything God does is for our own good. He's the manufacturer. He's your designer. He knows what works and what does not work. He knows you don't put diesel fuel in a gas tank. You go to the filling station today, and you put diesel in a gas engine, you'll ruin your engine. Okay, God loves us, and he wants to protect us. So, if you don't listen to God, you open yourself to sickness. Now, I know other people, I just swear, unfortunately, I know people that enjoy being sick. How you doing? Oh, I had this flu. Which flu is it? Oh, you know the flu, the bird flu. Okay. Oh, yeah, I'm having a hard time. Will you please pray for me? And I ask them the next week. Then I'll cough. Are you sick too? I had the same thing. Is there a tickle in your throat? And they're all excited, like, wow, we have something in common. We're both sick. I know people that all they do is complain of how sick they are. They enjoy it because they get sympathy. You know, I don't know about you, but I hate being sick. I don't like being sick. And you might ask yourself the question, why am I sick? I've known people that, unfortunately, through the years, we've dealt with a number of people, again, not in this church, that have been sick, and they have a habitual sick. Well, when I was a little boy, my mom said to me, oh, you're always sick. You're just like your uncle. He always gets sick. And so in his mind is planted that lie, you always get sick. You always get sick. Make no mistake, you and I, our mouth is a key that opens and closes doors. If you speak death over yourself, you invite a spirit of infirmity upon your life. I'm always getting sick. My father, Dad, if you're watching in Florida, God bless you. I'm going to give a little accolade to my dad and mom. It's good to see you, Mom and Dad. What happened to my father? He always used to get a cold. Well, it's a winter again. I always get this cough for 4 months, and here I go again. One day he's reading the Bible, and the Lord said, knock it off. Claim you're healed. So he said, you know what? In Jesus' name, I am not getting a cold this winter. And guess what? He didn't get a cold that winter. There was a time my dad had arthritis at 40 years old. He read the Bible and said, you know what? God's my healer. He prayed, and the arthritis went away for over 15 years. You see, don't give in to stuff, folks. You know, sickness is something that happens, but we don't have to accept a spirit of infirmity. Listen, I understand that people get sick, but let me encourage you with something. If you are sick, let's suppose you're a diabetic and you want God to heal you, okay? Well, I claim right now in Jesus' name, I am free of diabetes. And you throw your syringes and your pills in the toilet and you flush them down and you're like, I'm free. That's just dumb. Let me just say what it is. That's stupid, okay? Can I say that in church? All right. It's a big-ass word. Okay, stupid. What you should do is what my friend Gail Castle did, who was found to have a hole in her heart. She said, I am already healed. Do you realize all of us are already healed? Eventually, we'll all be perfect in heaven. But God, I want to realize my healing now. So she said, thanked every day. She took communion every day. Said, thank you, God, that you're healing my heart. Thank you, you're healing my heart. She took the pill. Thank you, you're healing my heart. Took the pill. After 6 to 9 months later, she went back to the doctor. Guess what? The hole in the heart was gone. Okay? Say, don't give thanks. Go ahead. Go. Come on. All right. She won't mind I said that. I hope not. But anyhow, but that's what she did. And I want to encourage you, for those of you who are struggling with high blood pressure or a lot of cholesterol in your body and all that kind of, well, first of all, don't have donuts every day. That's not helpful. Okay? But what I encourage you to do is eat right and all that. Yes, take the pill and say, Lord Jesus, I want to thank you for the medication that all healing comes from you, but I am not identified by my sickness. I may have high blood pressure, but that is not my definition. I am a child of God, and I am healed through Christ Jesus, and I claim healing upon myself. In Jesus' name, I will not bow to this cancer. I will not bow to this high blood pressure. I will not bow to anything. Christ is my healer. And I'm going to take this medication. I'm going to believe God for my healing, and I'm going to continue to go to the doctor and do what I have to do, but I am not going to be subject to this situation. You may, some of you suffer with depression. Well, I'm just depressed. My mother was depressed. My father was depressed. My dog was depressed. Listen, I understand that. I understand that. But why do you have to accept that? You say, yes, I struggle with depression, but my God is bigger than depression. And in him comes joy and joy everlasting. There's no condemnation, though. I'm struggling right now. God understands it. Jesus understands depression. He felt it in the garden. But Lord God, I thank you that I'm getting better every day. I'm getting better every day. No, I'm not getting better every day. If you don't want to get better any day, you say, what good is it to say, oh, I'm so depressed. I'm so depressed. I feel so blue. Well, that's the reason why. But I'm depressed. I'm depressed. I'm depressed. I'm depressed. I'm depressed. How you doing? Oh, you know, my depression. Then it becomes your pet. Now, I understand that there's chemical imbalances. I understand there's the situations, and the church has been really bad about this. I get it. But why not say, the Lord is my healer, and I take the medication? They used to say in World War II, praise the Lord and pass the ammunition. And I would say, praise the Lord and pass the medication, okay? God gave us that. Use it, pray over it, believe God, and understand that that's not your identity. Is that clear, everybody? I hope you understand. Hope that's balance, okay? We're not suggesting you just throw your medication away. But believe God for it. Believe God for it. So that's part of it. In Acts 10, verse 38, it says the following. How God anointed Jesus Christ, Jesus of Nazareth, with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all those who were oppressed, healing those that were oppressed by the devil. The devil can come in as spirit of infirmity. It could very well be. Make no mistake, I am convinced that probably over 60%, and I'm being very liberal in saying that, 60% of most illnesses that you and I face are a result of bitterness and unforgiveness.
forgiveness. When you hold bitterness against someone and unforgiveness, you know what it does? The Bible says you don't forgive a brother from your heart. Hand him over to the torturers. If you don't forgive your brother from your heart, God won't forgive you. The enemy comes in and goes, I got the big F there. Okay, the forgiveness thing. Come on in. You got it. I have the big, big forgiveness thing. I have a pass. You know what can happen? I mean, even psychologists and sociologists and doctors would tell you that unforgiveness is bad for your health. It'll actually hurt you. A lot of people are bitter, and as a result of that, it causes all kinds of problems. Your immune system gets compromised, and you can get sick. Okay? Now, please understand what I'm saying. If you're sick today, it does not necessarily mean you have a spirit of infirmity. But I will say this. The fallen nature of the world is upon us. So why not say, Lord, you're my healer? Why not go to God? When we had a prayer, we had a healing service here a couple of weeks ago. Please, don't take offense to this, okay? But every time this guy comes, Pastor Raymond Louie, we have a significant, we have like 3 or 4 or 5 miracles take place here. I don't know about you, but anytime there's a time I can get healed, I'll come. I want to put myself in a position to hear God's, receive God's healing. Why not pray? Believe God until God says no, okay? So make that clear. Just because you're sick does not mean it's from the devil, but it could be a sickness from the enemy. Make no mistake about it. What happens if it is? Well, you find it is, go to God, ask for forgiveness, ask God to heal you, and pay attention to the doctor, pay attention to healing, and sometimes you can see yourself get free of those types of things. Okay, now finally, I want to talk about iniquity, continue with it, talk about being sick. I want to conclude with this one thing is this, how to continually break free. I want to show you something I never saw before. It's so cool when you look in the Bible. I always see something new in the Bible when I read it. I'm going to show you something you probably hadn't seen before. So, open your Bibles, please, to Mark 7, verse 24 to 30. All right, here we go. Verse 24. From there, he arose and went to the region of Tyre. This is Jesus doing his ministry tour in Sidon. And he entered a house and wanted no one to know it, but he could not be hidden. For a woman whose daughter had an unclean spirit heard about him. Okay? There's a woman that has a demon-possessed daughter. Some of you think you have one, but okay. Anyhow, a demon-possessed daughter. An unclean spirit heard about him, and she came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek. Okay? In other words, she was not of the house of Abraham. She was an unbeliever. Syrophoenician by birth, and she kept asking him to cast out the demon out of her daughter. But Jesus said to her, this is a really troubling scripture. It used to bother me. Let the children be filled first, for it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. Now, can you imagine after the service, I say, hey, everyone, you have any questions today? Yes, Pastor. I'd like to know about freedom. Be quiet, you little dog. Can you imagine what would happen to me? Okay. I mean, that's rude. Call someone a dog? Yeah, okay. You guys didn't find that very funny. Okay. He said this, verse 28. And she answered and said to him, yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs under the table eat from the children's crumbs. Then he said to her, for this saying, go your way. The demon has gone out of your daughter, and when he has come to her house, she found the demon gone out of her daughter lying on the bed. Now, let me bring some things to your attention about this passage of Scripture. The Phoenicians were a wicked people in the time of Christ and leading up to Christ. Jezebel, have you heard Jezebel? She came from the Phoenician background, and she was into all kind of paganism and demonology and all that, and she introduced it to Ahab. Ahab was a weak man controlled by an evil wife. And so you had the Syria and Phoenician side, and they were also very prideful. And so they had a cult. How many of us allow this stuff in our life? Cultic movies, going to tarot card readers. You miss your mom, so you go to somebody, you don't want anyone to know about it, and so you go to this psychic person, and goes, oh, I see your mother, and I see you in a little pink jacket when you were 4. Oh, Mom, she's here. I can get on Facebook and find you had a pink jacket when you were 4 years old. How much more can the enemy do that, right? And so the enemy will fool you by this. You open the door to demonic presences.
by doing these types of things. Witchcraft, tarot card. How about this? And I'm going to really step on some toes here. How about celebrating Halloween? Oh, Pastor, stop it. Well, let me explain. I know putting a costume on is fine. But if you're putting on demon outfits, you got Freddy Krueger on and all that kind of stuff. You're making light, you're opening the enemy to things. Hallowed means holy. Halloween, you're celebrating darkness. Now, I understand a lot of it's good fun, but why make light of evil? You know, matter of fact, I have a friend of mine, former friend of mine, had a son who was kind of walking away from God just a little bit, but his parents prayed for his son all the time. His son went to a party. At this party, they were drinking and smoking weed and all that kind of stuff, and they had a Ouija board. And they were doing the Ouija board, and it was amazing because they were coming out with stuff and asking questions, and it would go to the right place. And then when this boy, I'll just call him Chris because I don't want to give his name away. Let's say Chris showed up at this party, and all of a sudden they're like, "What's going on? It's not working anymore." So they asked the Ouija board. This is what I heard from my pastor. I said, "Why is this not working?" And it spelled the name Chris, because Chris is here. And when Chris heard that, his heart went to his throat. He put his tail between his legs and ran out of the house and told his parents. You know why? Because he was prayed by his parents. And the covering of his parents were on him in a demonic environment. It could not function because of the prayers of his parents. Parents, pray for your kids. Amen? If you've been to these types of things, you need to ask God to forgive you from that because you opened a door to the enemy. Dungeons and Dragons, is that still around, right? I don't know if it is or not, but when I was growing up, it was the vogue. Getting involved with, trying to astral project and all this crazy stuff. There's Christians out there I know now that are sitting there and in the name of Jesus, they're astral projecting, they're trying to create universes and do crazy stuff. That's just, you're opening yourself to all kinds of crazy stuff. Don't do that. The cultic. And the woman was asked for deliverance. Now, remember, Jesus says it's not proper to give the children's bread to dogs. That's an insult. But you know what a dog means? I'll show you. In Mark 7:27, Jesus said, "Let the children be filled first, for it's not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." And that's what it says. Not right to get. It sounds really, really cruel. But you know what it says in Revelation 22:14? I'm glad you asked. Let's go read it together. Revelation 22:14-15. "Blessed are those who do this commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter through the gates of the city. But outside, there are dogs." Chihuahuas. No, he's not talking about Great Danes. He's not talking about dogs. He says, "But they're dogs and sorcerers and sexually immoral." This woman was involved with this type of thing. That's why he called her a dog. "And murderers and idolaters and whoever loves and practices sin." Dogs represents lost people. So don't go out and say, are you saved? Or are you just a dog? No, don't do that, okay? Don't. But you know what? You know what Paul said in Philippians 3:2? It says this. It says, "Beware of dogs. Beware of evil workers. Beware of mutilation." Do you know where we got the sign "Beware of dogs" from? The Apostle Paul. You guys are terrible. This is such a heavy topic. I'm trying to put a little, humor makes the theology go down. But anyhow, you're making it hard for me today. The Apostle Paul said, "Beware of the dogs." Those are people that are outside the faith, okay? Jesus was saying deliverance is not for lost people, but for children of God. The only way you and I can find true deliverance is by giving our lives to Jesus Christ, or otherwise your deliverance may be short at best. When you say, "I give my life to you, I hand the deed to you, God, you are mine, and I declare I give everything to you," the enemy can come in and say, "Okay, I got this one, get out in the name of Jesus." So Jesus was saying deliverance is not for lost people, but for believers. But what did the woman do? She did something that a lot of us don't do. She humbled herself. Maybe some of you today have inappropriate relationships on the internet. Perhaps you're going to lunch with people at work and you really like it. Your heart's beating when you go out and you see this person, you come alive. Big deal. It's called hormones. Are you a dog or are you a human being? Take authority over that. Don't give into that nonsense, folks. Come on. Don't do that. Choose to obey God. Don't give into that kind of thing. Humble yourself. Say, you know what? I got a problem. When I'm alone with a computer, I click to the wrong place. When I'm alone on a business trip, man, I run down to that bar and I flirt with girls that are not my wife. Why not fess up to it? Confess it. Get rid of it. Why be held bondage? The woman humbled herself. Will you humble yourself today? I want to encourage you that, you know how you get free? You get free by giving your life to Christ. You get free by having relationship with people in the church that will help you. I got folks that hold me accountable. Who on earth do you have to hold you accountable? We talked about the pilots checking the system before they take off. Who do you have? Do you have anyone that the Bible says faithful are the wounds of a friend, but profuse are the enemy's kisses? Iron sharpens iron, show another man sharpens one another. You and I need relationships. On the 21st of February, we're going to have small groups. I want to encourage every person, if you can, to get involved with a small group. If not, we'll make one for you. Oh, come on. A church program's going to solve my problem? No. A church program is not a church program. It's an opportunity to put yourself in an environment where you can create relationships that are healthy that help you grow in Christ. We're not called to do this all by ourselves. There's no Clint Eastwood Christianity, folks. Who's Clint Eastwood? Never mind. All right? But I want to encourage you that we need each other to grow. The Bible says, confess your sins to one another that you may be healed. All right? Christ has come to set us free. So Christ has, verse Galatians 5:1. So Christ has truly set us free. Now make sure you stay free and don't get tied up again in the slavery of the law. Let's bow our heads if we could. I just spoke about, with every head bowed, I just spoke about this morning that the children's bread is deliverance. But if you haven't given your life to Christ, then the freedom you seek to find will not come to you as it should. But if you give your life to Jesus Christ, you become the property of Jesus. And the property of Christ gives you power to eradicate and evict these things that are on your life. So I'm going to ask you a question. I'm going to pray a prayer right now. If you've never asked Christ in your heart, or if you've walked away and you said, I'm going to do it my way. Someone invited you to church, or you're watching this because someone told you to watch it. Listen, it's not about me. It's about the Word of God. God's got something great for you. He loves you. We're all in this together. Let's pray right now. I'm going to pray a prayer. And if you pray this prayer from your heart, you can begin a new beginning. Let's pray this quietly in your heart. Lord Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you died on the cross for me. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins, both known and unknown. And I give my life to you. I declare my life is no longer my own. I give my life to you. Fill me with your power and your presence to be able to live the life you have for me. I give my life to you afresh today. With every head bowed, real quick, can I just see a quick show of hands and say, Pastor, that was me. I pray. Can I just see real quick? Thank you. Anyone else saved this morning? Thank you. Anybody else? Come on, let's be bold here this morning. Anyone else this morning say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer for the first time. Thank you. Okay? I'm going to pray for the rest of you, the rest of us. Some of you are putting up with nonsense. Some of you are watching stuff you shouldn't be watching. Some of you are involved with relationships you shouldn't be involved with. Some of you have unforgiveness and bitterness. Listen, God loves you so much, He doesn't want to see you bent down with stuff. Some of you have a spirit of iniquity or a spirit of sickness on you that you just, let's pray right now in Jesus' name. Lord Jesus, we declare that we are yours. We ask you to forgive us for opening doors to the enemy. Doors of lust, doors of pride, doors of unforgiveness, doors of laziness, doors of rebellion in Jesus' name, doors of witchcraft, doors of pride. Lord, we just, right now, we confess our sins to you in Jesus' name. We declare that you are our God. And Father, we want to let go of this stuff right now in Jesus' name. I'm going to ask if the prayer team can make their way down. Maybe you need to get prayer this morning. It's okay. Prayer team, please come make your way down. Everyone, please stand up. We're going to have a concluding song. As we do that, we're going to open the altars. And the altar simply means the front area of the church where we pray for one another. Listen, we're not better than anyone else. Sometimes you need someone else to kind of go with it with you. Okay, let's come on. Let's be free, folks. Let's not walk out of here the same way we came. And by the way, if you prayed that prayer today, ask Christ in your heart, you do me a favor, please. Could you fill this card out and put it in one of the boxes or bring it to one of the people up forward? We have a special gift for you. We want to help you in your journey of faith. You're not called to do this alone. Esteban's going to leave us in a song.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
Come on, let's declare that.
There is power.
If you need prayer, come on up.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
Come on, lift that up.
There's power.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
There's power.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
To break every chain.
Leave the front here open. If the band wants to continue to pray or they want to stop, it's fine. We want to give you an opportunity to get prayer. Listen, folks, we're all in this together. Let's walk in freedom. Let's be the people God's called us to become. Amen? God bless you. May he keep you. May he shine his face upon you. Give you power to live the life he's called you to live in Jesus' name. God bless.
Break every chain, break every chain, break